Hello, so I'm here with Primrose Kitten.
Hi.
You probably recognise her from her massive channel. You probably subscribe anyway, but if you haven't done so already, I guess you've got a website.
Yeah, I've got a YouTube channel and I've got a website. Just go over, join us, we're all really friendly.
Yeah, so we're science teachers. We're now both YouTubers, which sounds a bit weird to say that.
I know.
I feel a bit of a fraud as a YouTuber.
I'm
more of a teacher, I think, than a YouTuber.
But yeah, when people ask what I do, and I'm like, oh, I'm a YouTuber, they're kind of like, what? And I'm like, yeah, I know.
I think probably the difference is we have something to say. I think we do anyway, you know, actually to help people and actually...
And it wasn't a thing when we were growing up. YouTube didn't exist then.
I don't know what we did. We just sort of talked to each other and I don't know.
Books.
Yeah. Anyway, I thought I'd just do a little bit of an interview because it's always nice to talk to other people. Maybe find out, I guess, what it was like for them at school, what they did in terms of subjects, and then a bit of their career, I suppose, to kind of end up where we are now. So, A-levels, what did you study?
I did biology, chemistry, maths, and further maths. Although I did regret taking further maths because that was four. That's a lot. But the maths department wouldn't let me drop it.
What did you do it to the end, did you? So you continued all to the end of year 13?
Yeah, they maybe continued to the end of year 13. We came to a compromise where... I didn't have to turn up for lessons anymore. I didn't have to revise for the exams anymore, but I had to turn up for the exams. I mean, I don't know why I turned up for the exams. They weren't going to do anything. Anyway, I turned up for the exams and I got a D in my further maths A level, having not gone to the classes or done any revision.
It's better than an E, isn't it?
It's better than an E.
Okay, and your other subjects that you were kind of working towards, how did they go? Biology and chemistry and stuff, all good?
Yeah, so I got B's in sciences and then a C in maths, which was enough to get me to university. It didn't meet my my offer.
Right.
I think my offer from Bath was an A and two B's or two A's and a B. And, like, BBCD was obviously way, way below what they were expecting.
But they let you in, did they?
They let me in. I'm still not 100% sure why or how this happened. But they did. They let me in.
So, Bath University. So, I live in Bath anyway. It's a beautiful city.
It's beautiful.
It's really lovely, actually. But why Bath? Why did you choose that kind of place?
This is quite... Well, I think it's an interesting story. Talking about me is really interesting. When I grew up in London... we used to go to science museum all the time because I was really still am into science, and I was dead set on going to a university in London. You know, I told everyone that's where I was going to go, that's going to be my first choice. And when I went there for the open day, I actually didn't like it. When I went to Bath, it was in February, it was Valentine's Day, I remember that, and it was blazing hot. So, like, we were all there in our like nice summer dresses, or interviews for Bath. You walk out of the South Building on campus, you walk out, there's the lake, there's the amphitheatre, there's the bar, and the amphitheatre, which is like grass overlooking the lake, was just full of people sitting around with their friends drinking pints in February in the sunshine, and I'm kind of like, this is where I want to spend the next 4 years of my life. And I did, and it was amazing.
And it's a campus university, so what do you mean by that?
So that means everything is in one place. So you live like 5 minutes away from lecture theatres. The lecture theatre at Bath is underneath the main bar, so...
theme going here.
Yeah. Frequently, we used to have... lectures at like 5 o'clock on a Friday, and like nothing since Friday morning, so we'd go to the pub for lunch and then we'd take our pints and sit at the back of the lecture theatre not making any
notes. I'll put a disclaimer on the video, so
this is not a good idea. However, Bath is an amazing university and I had a brilliant time.
And so biochemistry was your thing?
Yeah, so I did biochemistry. It's really cool. It's all the bits of my biology A level that I liked and all the bits of my chemistry that I liked. So I didn't like plants, so I didn't want to do that. I didn't like industrial chemistry, so I didn't want to do that. It's like all how cells work and DNA and all the cool bits I actually did like from my A-levels.
So, biochemistry degree, you became a biochemist, is that right? Or
yes, I did.
Okay.
I know, it's very biology chemistry, A-level biochemistry degree, and then I went to be a biochemist. I walked straight into a job. I think my last exam was on the 7th of June, and I started work on the Monday, which I think was about the 10th of June. So I had Friday, Saturday, Sunday off to move halfway across the country, started work on the Monday, and I used to work for Marie Curie Cancer Care back when they had a research institute, which they don't have anymore, and was researching how cells knew to divide. So if you're doing alien biology, you know the microtubules come from the sides, they grab hold of the chromosomes die down the middle, and when they're ready, there's a signal that tells the cell to divide. Mm-hmm. I was looking at things with interfere with that signal, which means the cell would divide prematurely, so your two daughter cells wouldn't have an equal number of chromosomes, and that sort of thing that could give rise to cancer. So that's what I did for 4 years, I think.
I don't understand anything that you said, but it sounds like really important work, and like really, because it's using the science, it's like using your degree, you're kind of looking at science, it's being a proper scientist, isn't it?
Yeah, it was being a proper scientist. It was a really, really fun place to work. I met my husband there, I made loads of really great friends there. It was close to London, so I used to go in London all the time. It was close to a really nice pub where we used to go for lunch all the time. It's just really bad.
Yeah.
But in the end, it was literally just watching cells divide over and over and over and over and over and over again, and it got a little bit boring.
Yeah, no, it does sound. I think that, so the job is good, but maybe actually day to day, although it's, you know, it's important, it's not the most exciting thing.
Yeah.
And so what made you then become a science teacher?
Well, there's another step in the middle there. Okay, so you didn't just, I didn't just go from there. I went to UCL.
Yeah.
Started an ill-fated PhD in autism in worms. Again, it was really boring.
Did you say autism in worms?
Yes.
Okay.
So there were lots of different causes of autism, and I was looking at a genetic cause of autism where you would have like a gene that would probably, you know, if you had four brothers who all had autism, then this would be one of the genes that was potentially responsible for it.
Okay.
So one of the genetic causes of autism, and if you knock it out in worms, they didn't wiggle correctly. So teeny tiny little sea elephant worms.
That's pretty cool.
You are a millimetre long, and I used to bash them on the head and decide whether they wiggled good or not. You know, all of this sounds like really, really good and wear this stuff. However, it was really, really boring.
I can imagine the day to day, you know, you're going in at 9 o'clock in the morning, whatever it might be.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, that's 8 hours or 9 hours a day of that.
Bashing worms on the head.
Yeah, fair enough. And is that when you decided to become a science teacher?
Yeah. So UCL had this great program called Researchers in Residence, where they took PhD students like me, who were really, really sad at the time, and threw us into schools. And I was in a school in central London teaching physics, actually.
Awesome.
And then decided that I was going to have a bit of time off to sit on the sofa and be really, really sad and then be a teacher.
Awesome. So being a science teacher, it's actually a really good job.
I absolutely loved it.
But what made you kind of start making videos? Because I guess a few other people have done it. Not many, really, in terms of thousands of science teachers. There's only a few people making stuff on YouTube. What made you kind of do that first video?
So I was in a school where, you know, I was teaching lots and lots of physics. And while I was on maternity leave, I just started making videos for the students that were still in school. I was literally just making videos for my classes. When I went back, I would, you know, teach them, and then I'd set them a video that I'd made to watch the homework so we could, like, get twice as much stuff done. So we could get through stuff in time for our exams. And then, like, you know, I went back at the beginning of the year, by the time exams came around, people had started watching the videos, and then I just kept making videos, and that was 4 years ago.
And did you have a plan that this would be your full-time job? This
was like your thing? There was literally no plan. I just made videos that my students needed.
Cool.
And then more people watch the videos, and more people ask the videos, and I'm like, okay, I'll make more videos.
But,
and then,
but now you're not just making videos as well. There's like a massive stack of books. Hopefully you can see these.
Quite all of them.
So yeah, but there's like, so you've gone from like just making video content to like being a published author.
Yeah, it's just cool. You know, writing stuff that students need.
Yeah.
The big thing at the moment is like the changes in the exams, how the exam questions aren't what they used to be in the old sophistication, how we can better prepare students for that. So it's doing stuff that students need.
Yeah.
So
I think people do need that, because we've got 100,000 followers now.
Yay,
so by the time the video is out, it'll be over 100,000. So it's definitely popular amongst students. What's sort of next? So you've done loads of GCSE, you've done science and maths, and then you're sort of doing a bit more at the moment, are you?
Yeah, I mean, still need to finish off science and maths, and then A-level biology, A-level chemistry, And then, you know, I might take a weekend off or something crazy like that.
So A-level chemistry, so I know I'm doing A-level physics and stuff like that, and that's just what I've been concentrating on. A-level chemistry, how's that going?
Yeah, I mean, chemistry is always my first subject. Absolutely love it. Got the practical videos done, doing loads and loads of questions on my website, loads and loads of workbooks being prepared. It's just, chemistry is really, really good fun. So I'm really, really enjoying this a lot more than I enjoy making GCSE maths videos, I will admit.
Yeah, I must say that when you're doing, I mean, GCSE is important. It's like everybody's got to do it. A-level, you can really go into like your subject knowledge. It's really in depth, and actually often it's a little bit more interesting, I think, as well.
Much more interesting, yeah.
Yeah, although I found when I did A-level chemistry, it was really difficult. Just, I found it so much harder than the maths and physics, but I guess that was me. I guess I didn't have videos to like refer to, and you know, a bit of a plug there. But yeah, so where do we find your stuff?
Over my website, my YouTube channel. If you just search for Primrose Kitten, then hopefully I'll come up somewhere.
Cool. Thanks for the interview.
Great.
Thank you.